Once again, I am welcoming all my dear friends to the second part of the chapter World in 20th Century. 20th നൂറ്റാണ്ടിൽ ചരിത്രത്തിൽ ഇടം നേടിയ പ്രധാന സംഭവ വികാസങ്ങളാണ് ഈ യൂണിറ്റിൽ നമ്മൾ ചർച്ച ചെയ്യുന്നത്. In previous class, we have studied about the imperialism, the capitalism, the world war, World War I and World War II, about Nazism and Fascism, and about Adolf Hitler and Mussolini, etc. And in today's class, let's continue the remaining portions of the chapter, World in 20th Century. Let's begin. Now, let's begin with the first topic, Cold War. Cold War, the open yet restricted rivalry that developed after World War II between the United States and the Soviet Union and their respective allies. The Cold War was waged on political, economic and propaganda fronts and had only limited resources to weapons. The term Cold War was first used by the English writer George Orwell in an article published in 1945 to refer to what he predicted would be a nuclear stalemate between two or three monstrous superstates which possessed of a weapon by which millions of people can be wiped out in a few seconds. It was first used in the United States by the American financier and presidential advisor Bernard Baruch in a speech at the State House in Columbia, South Carolina in 1947. From 1953 to 1957, Cold War tensions relaxed somewhat, largely owing to the death of the long-time Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin in 1953. Nevertheless, the standoff remained. A unified military organization among the Soviet bloc countries, the Warsaw Pact was formed in 1955 and West Germany was admitted into NATO that same year. Another intense stage of the Cold War was in 1958 to 62. The United States and the Soviet Union began developing intercontinental ballistic missiles, and in 1962, the Soviet began secretly installing missiles in Cuba that could be used to launch nuclear attacks on US cities. This sparked the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, a confrontation that brought the two superpowers to the brink of war before an agreement was reached to withdraw the missiles. So this was all about the Cold Wars. Now let's study about non-alignment moments. In history of the world, Western countries always dominated to undeveloped countries at that time. So after the World War II ended in 1945, United Nations had formed. US and USSR were developed at that time also, and conflict led between them. At the same time, many countries were attaining independence. Some countries, including India, were afraid to misuse of powers on them, so they formed non-aligned groups to secure themselves by mutual cooperation. So, Afro-Asian nations continued to oppose colonialism and Western domination. This led to non-alignment moments. Now let's check what is called decolonization. During the post-Second World War period, the dominance of imperial powers was questioned. European countries could not suppress the intensified nationalist movements in the colonies. And the USA and the USSR, which emerged as superpowers after the Second World War, supported freedom movements in various colonies. Gradually, colonies started to secure freedom from the imperialist control. This process is called decolonization. Now I will explain how did decolonization and Cold War led to the formation of non-alignment movements. Following the Second World War, many Asian, African and Latin American countries became independent. They realized that the Cold War was yet another phase of imperialism and that it would threaten world peace. The liberated nations decided not to join any of the blocs and formed the non-aligned movements. They understood that the race of superpowers would pose a harm to them. They realized that only world sans wars and conflicts can accelerate economic and social development. So these are the main relevance of non-alignment. The major military pacts formed during the Cold War are NATO, which means North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Then SCERT, which means Southeast Asian Treaty Organization. Then CENTO, Central Treaty Organization and Warsaw Pact. These are the main military pacts formed during the Cold War. Now let's look what are the events that led to the disintegration of the Soviet Union. Failure in bringing about changes in economic sector, regulation on freedom of expressions and opinion, overimportance of defense, corruption and inefficiency of the bureaucracy, the administrative measure of Gorbachev. These are the major significant events that led to the disintegration of the Soviet Union. There are a lot of changes that the disintegration of the Soviet Union brought to the world. Mainly, the Cold War ended and the policies and programs of the capitalist countries remained unquestioned. A unipolar world emerged under the leadership of the USA in the place of a bipolar one. Next topic that we are going to discuss is New Imperialism. Let's look how does the New Imperialism affect the economy of third world countries. New kind of imperialism emerged in the post-war period. Multinational companies which are registered in a country and functioning in many countries began to interfere in the economic, social and cultural sectors of the latter for serving the interest of the capitalist countries. It is known as New Imperialism. Multinational companies competed with one another to control the resources and assets of the third world countries. They promoted consumerism in the third world countries to sell their products. Developing nations were considered as the markets for multinational companies. The products of developed nations started reaching even in villages of the developing nations. Due to the pressure from multinational products and marketing strategies, the economy of many countries started to collapse. Moving on to the various concepts of New Imperialism. Liberalization, privatization and globalization. These are the major concepts of New Imperialism. Adoption of liberal regulations and taxation systems facilitate the import of multinational products to domestic markets. This was the major concept of liberalization. Privatization of public sector undertaking is an attempt to promote private sector. In globalization, economic system of the country linked to global economy. The interests and the motives of the multinational companies are protected. Competition-driven markets came into existence. Trans-border flow of products, services, raw materials, capital, latest technology and human resources are facilitated. These are the main concepts of globalization. World Bank, International Monetary Fund, which means IMF, World Trade Organization, WTO. These international organizations are devising and executing various policies in favor of globalization. Let's study now about Industrial Revolution and how did Industrial Revolution cause the colonization. Industrial Revolution began in England in the 18th century. It gradually spread to other countries of Europe. Capitalist investment in factories and production was increased. This increased their profit. It paved the way for capitalism. The capitalist controlled production and distribution. This economic system is known as capitalism. The advent of large-scale industries enhanced capital investment. Many nations produced more than what they needed. Domestic markets of these nations were not enough to sell these products. The overproduction forced them to search for markets in other countries. The search for markets by the industrialized countries in Europe led the competition among them. Using political power and military forces, the European countries exploited these nations economically. Later, these nations became the colonies of European countries. This process is known as colonization. Imperialism is different from colonization. In colonization, colonial country is considered the colonies as the source of raw materials and the market for their industrial products. But in the case of imperialism, imposing a nation's political, economic and cultural dominance on another nation is called imperialism. Colonialists impose the dominance using legal systems, administrative measures, military forces, etc. Decolonization is the next topic that I am going to discuss. During the post-Second World War period, dominance of imperial powers was questioned. European countries could not suppress the intensified nationalist movements in the colonies. The USA and the USSR, which emerged as superpowers after the Second World War, supported freedom movements in various colonies. Gradually, colonies started to secure freedom from the imperialist control. This process is called decolonization. Okay, my dear friends, let's conclude this lesson with the last topic, the formation of United Nations Organization, which means the UNO. Although the League of Nations was established following the First World War, it failed to maintain world peace. After the Second World War, efforts were taken to set up an organization for perceiving global peace. This resulted in the establishment of the United Nations Organization on 24th October 1945. The headquarters of the UNO is in New York, United States of America. Some of its objectives are to save the succeeding generations from the scourge of war, to protect international treaties and laws, and to foster social and economic developments of countries. So my dear friends, this was all about the chapter, The World in the 20th Century. See you in next video with another interesting chapter for you. Till then, goodbye.